Mockingjay Part 2 starts pretty much immediately after the end of Mockingjay Part 1, and we know that Peeta's, you know, back in District 13 and pretty messed up.
It's because of Katniss.
It wasn't because of her.
She'd tell you to say that.
She'd tell me.
In Katniss's mind, she kind of tries to block out Peeta because she's like, that's not Peeta anymore. That's not something else. That's not him.
She's a monster! She's a mutt that the Capitol created to destroy us!
Get her out of there.
You don't understand me!
You have to-
Once she gets Peeta back and then sees the way he's been destroyed, her mission shifts completely to one of revenge. She wants Snow dead. She wants him to pay. And in a way, it goes even beyond the revolution.
At the end of Catching Fire, we're shocked by how abrupt an ending it was and how, in the final pages, Suzanne really just changed the whole story and the whole structure of the series with one sort of breakout of the arena. And with book three, it's that shock and surprise, and anything could happen at any moment. It's pervasive through the whole book.
And it's also the movie in which the arena becomes a war.
The Capitol streets and the pods underground and the sewers and the lizards, that all becomes the new arena. And the kind of game that President Snow creates now comes out of the revolution and the war that's going on in the Capitol streets.
The series is amazing because it's a condemnation of war. It's really about the costs of warfare, what it does to individuals, what it does to families, what it does to nations, and how it doesn't stop unless we stop it.
The Katniss, she's been pushed, pulled, and shoved in so many different directions. Like, you kind of hope and want her to be able to live happily ever after in a quiet, peaceful manner with her kids and Peeta for the rest of her life.
I killed Emily. I killed Finnegan. I'm sorry, Pollux.
Katniss, she's kind of numb. I think she's been through so much, and when she kind of decides that this role as the Mockingjay is a lot bigger than her personal gain, it's about the future of the world, I think that she becomes genuinely okay with dying. She's just solely focused on a better future for everyone.
As she starts to sort of see the more complete picture by the end of the movie, I think she becomes truly the person who speaks for her country, who does what her country needs her to do. She becomes a patriot at that point, and this sort of selfish agenda becomes a very selfless agenda. One of the reasons why we really needed to split this last book was because Katniss and Peeta have such a journey to go on together, and that you can't really truncate it.
Mockingjay Part 2 is a very different story from Mockingjay Part 1. I mean, if Part 1 is in the scope of the entire series, the sort of second act low point for Katniss, you know, she's sort of sidelined, she's being manipulated, it's much more political, there's less action, there's no arena, you know. This one is sort of a shift back for her as a character, where she's sort of taking control of her own life.
And as she starts to evolve and starts to see that she's not going to take it anymore, and she understands the value of this fight and what's at stake here, you start to see the shift happening through her eyes.
We actually struggle quite a bit in the script phase about whether to put the nut in the first movie or the second movie. She gets shot. It's a big dramatic event. We ultimately made the decision, and I'm very happy with where we put it, to put it in the second movie. But it's that moment, the way that she sort of steps up and gives that impromptu speech about Snow and about trying to get the diehard loyalists of Two to turn their weapons to Snow. I think it's a great dramatic moment. It's Katniss sort of fully realized as a revolutionary, writing her own script, giving a call to war and a call to action.
Tonight, turn your weapons to the Capitol.
Well, I think Katniss, Peeta, and Gale are all grown-ups by now. I mean, it's really amazing how much, even though it's such a short amount of time, the events of Hunger Games and Catching Fire really cause them to become adults. And I think you see that immediately on the page in Mockingjay, that the concerns aren't teenager concerns anymore. They are adult concerns. And I think they are taking their place not just in relation to one another, but in the world, and that they realize that their decisions have much more meaningful implications than they ever imagined their small decisions ever would.
Two-tiered explosion.
You allow people enough time to rush in, help the wounded, then.
A second bomb.
Right. Second one goes off here.
I guess there are no rules anymore about what a person can do to another person.
I don't think Snow used any rule book when he hijacked Peeta.
What's so amazing about what Suzanne Collins has done is she's written political allegory for young adults, for children and young adults. And it's very rare that you see something so substantive about who we are as human beings, how we relate to one another, what politics mean, what rebellion means, you know, all of that. And I think with a character like Katniss, one of the things that I love that Suzanne does and I think is really stressed in the film is how close she is to her family. There's so much in the drama about the loss of her father, in the fact that she feels responsible for her mother, and that she really feels responsible for her sister. So all of her so-called political actions came from a personal place, which, of course, is the nature of politics, that the personal is political. But it's a big idea. It's a very, very big idea and an important one for children to grasp.
Suzanne, she's been the real guide, and especially on the sort of the Katniss compass throughout this process, and making sure that we stay true to her and stay true to the character. And it's been an enormous help. And I mean, even from the beginning on Catching Fire, I sat with her and went through the book and created the beat sheet with her. And so we did the same with the Mockingjay movies. And so she's been a huge part of the story process throughout.
I'm going to kill Snow. Nothing good is safe while he's alive. And I can't make another speech about it.
It's a dark story. It's a dystopic kind of futuristic thing. And it's about a government that has kind of taken a totalitarian kind of approach to how it's going to govern its people. Naturally, the only way it can come to an end is an extreme, potentially violent conflict. And that's what we have in this. And so I think that it is fitting for the story. It's dark, but it's also, for me, it feels more real this way.
The books are targeting teens, ideally beyond that, right? And violence can quite easily sort of get you into an R rating. And so what's been really interesting is to stay as thematically and emotionally true as possible and to try and treat the violence in a very thematic and emotional way. So you're really seeing and feeling the consequence of it so that it's important and it's not entertainment, and that it sort of connects with theme.
Mr. Heavensbee, you're the game maker. I want everyone to know whatever game she's playing, she's playing it for us. What I wanted to do with Coin, I wanted people to be disappointed in her. I wanted people to believe that here was someone who was going to lead people out of the darkness and into a place where they could all be free and happy. And instead, she's a character who becomes ultimately corrupted by her own desire for power. So that thing about, you know, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. You know, that's what happens to Coin.
I had the privilege of knowing a small town girl from the seam in District 12.
Not only does she want to take control and end the war, but she wants to end the war by establishing her overweening power. She's saying, now we'll take their kids.
The children will be received first.
I love that in the books. I love that in the movie. I liked playing that because I felt like that was the root of her evolution, that idea that so much had been taken from her, her family, and her life, that she was like, now we'll take your children. It's an eye for an eye in the most horrific way.
If I'm honest, I'm totally fearing seeing the movie on screen because I know it's going to be so devastating. it's hard to say, oh, what are you looking forward to seeing in Mockingjay? Because it's such a trial by fire, and it is so devastating, and it takes such a toll. I think the power of the book is how deeply you feel for the characters, and then to see what they go through. If you're sitting there enjoying yourself and having a great time, then something is wrong. I think you're instead going to sit there and really feel strongly about what's going on. And hopefully get some meaning from the pain of watching this happen.
I'm sure she wasn't gunning for your sister, but these things happen in war.
Certainly she has been changed by the experiences that she's had. She is a veteran, and she has a lot of the scars to show it. And she has a desire to not feel her feelings, to just sort of shut down.
Get out! Prim is gone! Prim is gone!
I think it's very powerful, the moment with Buttercup, where she finally lets herself mourn and lets herself feel her feelings.
Get out! It really just felt very closing, you know? It was so much to put onto one person, but I feel like it was important to show, you know, a true perspective of the consequences of war, instead of, you know, taking the heroes out of it where these things are happening to everyone else. You know, to have a hero directly affected in that way, I felt like was really powerful and necessary.
What's amazing is that her story is told, and what a bloody story it's been. Hey. She's quite literally been on one hell of a roller coaster, mainly with downward sort of trajectory most of the time. I do think it perfectly sums up everything that's happened. It's a perfect way to kind of finish and to sort of finalize that chapter. What happens from here on out is everyone's guess and everyone's sort of imagination.
What was important to me is that because of everything that everybody's been through, that the movie ends with some hope. That for now, life is better. But it was also very important to me that it ended with a feeling that she's not perfect and that she never will be perfect.
You love me. Real or not real?
Real.
The point is, in fact, to see them surviving and that you've seen them go through things, and obviously, Katniss has lost her sister, which is the very thing she went into the games to save. But you have to see how they're haunted by that. And you have to see how, even if they won in the end of the immediate action, when you look at the afterward in the epilogue, you see that they have to live with this, and that the whole point of it is to live with what they've learned and what they've experienced, and not to shove it aside, but instead to, again, survive and make that a part of their life. And by remembering it, hopefully make a better life for whoever comes after.
Mockingjay Part 2. It's really about opening the world up as much as possible for the greatest respect for the underlying material and respect for the audience. There are a lot of fans out there who, you know, have high expectations for this franchise, and you don't want to let them down, and you don't want to take them for granted. So the pressure was on us to make sure that the world grew and the spectacle of it grew, but stayed connected again with the story and with the reality of it.
Fun thing about Mockingjay 2 was all going to be in the Capitol. That was the war movie. The hard thing with the Capitol is that everybody knows it doesn't exist. You know, that's so you're not trying to recreate New York, or you're not trying to recreate San Francisco or whatever, but you're creating something that everybody inherently knows does not exist.
Even before I joined these movies, Phil had a real sense of how he imagined the Capitol to look. And you didn't see that much of it in the first movie. I mean, a couple of matte paintings and things, but there wasn't much really explored. And so this was the first real opportunity to sort of go into the streets and see and feel and experience the Capitol. And so we went back to some of those original plans, and a lot of his ideas were sort of based on the plans for Germania, which would, you know, be the giant sort of capital city that Hitler would have built had they won the war.
Phil Messina, he has just wowed me at every level. This movie had so many locations and such diverse locations.
The great thing about Phil's work is that he's not afraid to create a world and to go big. And he's very creative. He makes great sets.
I'd been doing some sewer research, and we knew that we had a lot of underground tunnels in District 13. There were all more circular, sort of tube-like ellipses, ovals. For the sewers for the Capitol, I knew I wanted to use more kind of like hard edges, and I ended up finding this reference of some sewers. I don't even know where it is now, but it had this kind of great, like, geometric cross-section to it. And I showed it to Francis. I said, I think the sewers should look like this for the Capitol. And he said, yeah. And he said, one thing I want to do is I want to make the ceiling super low. Like, I don't want a big, expansive sewers. I want to make it like this sequence with the lizards is scary. It's trying to work with weapons in a confined space. I got 14 actors in there. I want to really, like, bring it down. So I ended up building hundreds of feet of sewer system on stage. And we reused a lot of pieces over and over because it's in the dark. It's a sewer. It's the same thing. But keeping the ceilings low, and then we even lowered them more with pipes overhead.
So what I like about Francis as well as Phil is that he's a little fearless in creating a set that's uncomfortable. And I know the actors probably aren't always like terribly thrilled with that, because that was the most awful set to shoot in. It had water in it up to your knees, and it was probably about 5.5 feet tall, so you had to be constantly hunched over just to be in it. And so trying to dress it, I mean, my set dressers had like gouges in their head and scratches and scrapes and bruises.
When I went to the stage and saw Dave Thompson, the camera operator, with the hard hat on, I knew, you know, because we used real pipes. It's like, you know, it was, he's like, no, I get it. But it was between the water on the floor, which I think started kind of like getting a little skanky after the first week, the dark, the bending over. I think the crew kind of lived that experience as viscerally as the actors did. They were right in there with them, and we didn't pull walls out. We were in those tight little spaces.
Oh. Yeah, you're good.
Will the arrows go?
Yeah, you're good.
More than a big, broad action sequence, Francis wanted it to be scary.
Okay, set and action.
And one of the reasons we decided to choose the Alexa in the first place was because we knew we had a bunch of stuff, you know, underground, whether it was 13 or the sewers and all of that, and that we could use a lot of practical lights, like lights on guns or lights, you know, sconces on walls and things like that, and keep things, you know, very minimal.
And action! And boom!
And we were originally very inspired by Alien, the Ridley Scott movie, which is another very claustrophobic movie. The way they used practicals and the way they used like the lighting in the spaceship to light people, and they just existed in its environment, and sometimes you just saw walls lit, but then the people would be in silhouette, and you know, we talked about a lot of that stuff, and we showed it to Phil, and he was like, okay, I see what you guys are going for, and then, you know, he did a lot of the lighting design in the rooms, and that's a great thing to have as a production designer to create these worlds that help me out.
We were, you know, well over having done all of the sort of bunker sets, and then we were starting to do all the sort of like warfare sets. So it was kind of a breath of fresh air in the middle of all of that to do this really sort of like a little bit outrageous sort of store for this like really outrageous character.
Tigress's shop was sort of very kind of trying to be as fabulous as we could up above, And then the kids, again, end up in a basement where it's like water's dripping, and it's like they can't catch a break, you know, no matter where they go. They're always in like this dank, you know, dark places. So that to me was like, I wanted to make the basement just like real life, nasty.
Well, I think going from this whole underground society into, you know, sort of like full-on warfare and battle was kind of an interesting prospect. In the second film, to go above ground and be completely out in the open and have this sort of vulnerability to all the sets, you know, and to have all the destruction and the rubble and to create these destroyed environments, you know, there was a really great contrast between the two movies.
So this is actually 1.25 pound foam with a very, very thin sheetrock mud and paint mix, which gives it that very three-dimensional image of cement. It has a solid core to it, wood, so they're actually pretty strong for transport. We got 40 total done.
The main set piece, the hovercraft bombing, the end where Prim's death, to the gates of the presidential mansion, we have foreground elements, but the background's gonna be all CG. It was the largest green screen that I've ever seen before.
I think we have close to 100 guys, and I heard that we had close to 500 containers surrounding this whole set, so it's quite a few.
The set's about 575 feet long, this one in particular that we're talking about, and the back extension, which is located over there, is on a different part of the facility.
With the two sets together, you're creeping up on 900 feet, something like that.
The main set piece, that was actually done over two different locations on the same piece of property because we couldn't get enough of a run with the sun direction going in the right way. So the street for the beginning up to a checkpoint was done in one place, and then we replicated the checkpoint and then the big open expanse in another part of the property. It was how to make something that's big even bigger, you know?
The presidential palace, the party of the year.
In Catching Fire, the Snow Mansion is a beautiful mansion outside Atlanta, and it served that film perfectly. But, you know, as we moved into Mockingjay, there were more rooms in that mansion that we needed. We found a chateau in Paris that opened his world up for us.
When you're shooting at a location like Chateau Voisin, you just can't build that. Either in CG or Filmicina couldn't build that kind of scale, and the same with the interiors. It just feels real.
The chateau, that was a great find because it augmented the Swan House. It felt like you could walk from the Swan House in Atlanta to this chateau in Paris, and, you know, details of the floor, the, you know, black and white check of the floor kind of matched, the detailing matched, but it was all just a little bit bigger. And we used every main public space on the ground level. But the biggest thing was coming out of the house and seeing this greenhouse that Snow has been imprisoned in at the very end of the movie. We knew it was probably too big to build on the grounds of the chateau in Paris, which would have been the perfect place for it. So we ended up building it on stage in Atlanta. It was beautiful. It came out really great. And then a small just entrance section at the chateau for her just to walk into.
Phil did an amazing job. And it would just, you know, sort of blow us all away stepping onto to one of his new sets.
Filmicina, just tremendous. And what imagination and what beauty. And, you know, you really got to have some serious talent. So I think he did a great job.
Sometimes killing isn't personal.
I think one of the things that drew me to these projects in the first place is the idea of the consequence of war and the consequence of violence. And so they're all getting a little bit older, and I think what may have been an easier thing to sort of tap into or to play is now a tougher thing when you get older, to sort of dig down into some real life experience and let that hang around for a day. It takes more of a toll.
Snow has to pay for what he's done.
It's hard to see Peeta this way.
That's not Peeta.
What is expected of Jen in these movies gets harder and harder with each successive movie, and that here in this last movie, she experiences the greatest loss and also the awakening of a character to kind of coming into her own, damaged but complete.
Jennifer is the one who kind of carries this whole thing on her back, and you're in her shoes, you're in her mind, and you're experiencing every change through her eyes. And it just couldn't be an actor more capable of carrying out that complexity successfully than Jennifer, because there's so much behind those eyes, emotion and thought and caring.
Well, I got to work with Liam a lot more on this film, so that was really great. He normally misses out on all the action and stuff.
I guess there are no rules anymore about what a person can do to another person.
I don't think Snow used any rule book when he hijacked Peeta.
Katniss and Gale's relationship's still really confusing. They have very conflicting ideas about what's too far in war. And Peeta's been hijacked in part one, so he's slowly regaining his sort of his consciousness back and you know, himself.
They use tracker checker venom on me. That's what the doctors on 13 said.
I think that, you know, especially for Josh, it was interesting because Josh is such a light, fun guy. He really had to do some stuff in this that he hadn't had to do before. I think he probably had one of the tougher parts in this, just in terms of sort of trying to navigate somebody who's so damaged to sort of starting to heal up through the course of the story.
Peeta, we have to keep going.
I'm a mutt.
We have to keep going.
You can't keep
yes, you can.
Leave me, I'm a mutt.
Look at me. Look at me. Stay with me.
Always.
This role is a very demanding role. You're asked to do something which doesn't really exist in real life, this notion of hijacking, but to make it feel real, and then to make the recovery from it feel real. I think he does an incredible job.
I just can't tell what's real and what's made up anymore.
Kind of the process of like getting to that darkness and that sort of psychosis or whatever came from us just talking about what the tortures were like that he went through, like what happened to him in the Capitol. They had, you know, tracker jacker venom that they inserted into me, and then like altered memories, so there's that element. But then there's also, like we said, like malnutrition, we said like certain kind of restrictive torturing, possibly like, you know, some kinds of water torture and things like that. And so it just really kind of getting into that mindset, Francis and I talked quite a bit about that.
He really blew me away in this film. Josh was really incredible. Normally I have trouble like acting with Josh, we can't make eye contact because we just know each other too well. But watching him in those scenes, I didn't recognize any part of him.
That scene with me and Josh was intense. I mean, we were both really nervous. I mean, it was kind of, for both of our characters, a very climactic scene. Extremely intense for Josh, exhausting physically.
She knows that you're here. Now, no, you can't trust her. She's a mutt.
But it was just so emotional for me. Prim is there to help him and try to convince him that Katniss is not trying to kill him or anyone else, and she's just trying to help because the Capitol has brainwashed him and he's just a mess.
She's a monster! You have to kill her!
Well, there she is. The Mockingjay.
I love Joanna. I wish she could be in more of it, but I just love, you know, Jenna's a great actress. She's great to have around, and she's so good as Joanna, and so fun, you know, in her relationship with Katniss. So it was a real joy to shoot those scenes.
For me, the most interesting part of Mockingjay is the relationship between Joanna and Katniss has really shifted. They've both been stripped of everything that they love. I mean, there is nothing left. And that now, you know, Katniss is being used as even more of a political figure, and I think that she's still on her team, and I think that it's the first time they've really seen each other eye to eye.
Anybody can kill anybody, Katniss, even a president. You just have to be willing to sacrifice yourself.
I, Finnico, dare take you, Annie Cresta, as my wife from this day forth.
It's such a dark, dark film with, you know, the subject matter is so horrendous.
When I was lost, you were the light that kept me going.
So you have to kind of keep things
light at times just to sort of, so you can go to those dark places. And so there was that, it's a really lovely energy the whole time of this lovely mix of seriousness and everyone really passionate about the subject matter and the material we were doing, but that ability to kind of snap out of it for a few moments so you can keep your, you know, I think it's really a healthy way of doing it. And that wedding is sort of like the epitome of hope for the future for all the characters.
Strangely, like, other than the wedding, we didn't have huge amounts of time to kind of spend together, really. I think purely because once they're reunited, Finnick then goes off. He's like, oh, yeah, now we're married, love, get used to this. Definitely moment, I mean, she's incredible, incredibly talented, incredibly so lovely, like, incredibly, like, just joyous, and every morning, without fail, should be smiling and happy to see it, you know, happy to go to work, and that kind of reinvigorated my love for going to work and wanting to do these films.
Woody and Elizabeth are both, you know, fantastic actors. They're also very, very iconic parts of this series. And they haven't been in a lot of Mockingjay Part 2. You know, they're in a little bit of the beginning and a little bit of the end, but they're such a part of the fabric of the movies that I think that what little they do in the movies lands in a big way.
Now, when you look at, you know, Effie and the degree to which her humanity has been awakened and how deeply she cares for Katniss, I find that to be really also very poignant and very emotional.
We wanted to sort of rein her back in, you know, and really, she's more mature. That's really what it came down to. It's like, she's still the same woman, but she's obviously evolved, and she's more professional.
I love the kiss between Haymitch and Effie. I like to think that maybe, you know, there might be something there. You never know.
Take care of her.
I will.
I have a crush on Elizabeth Banks. I'm not going to lie. I think she's a beautiful woman. I think she's a marvelous actress, and I just love her as a person. She's as fun as can be. She didn't know I was even gonna do it, and I just kissed her. And then she's such a pro, you know. So when we did it, it wasn't like just a light thing where we thought it was nothing. It was really like, okay, well, this is, you know. And hopefully, you know, once we do the sequel to this that no one's expecting, including the author, you know, something will pick up with these two.
Woody's always looking for what's funny in the scene. And it's really important in this movie when these movies get dark.
Let's focus on what it is you gotta say. Now, Plutarch wrote a speech.
I'm not saying that.
Okay, didn't think so.
He told me it was the best experience he's ever had on any movie. You know, I mean, I think, and it was, for them, it was a long time too. That's a lot. That's a lot. But I don't know that I have worked with a bunch of people who are easier and more generous and who really enjoyed the process of movie making.
Coin. Crowd.
You know, all these incredible themes just get bigger and bigger about your sense of self, identity, the individual against the state, about tyranny and the corruption of power. And there's so many great stories on a personal level. There always has been in Hunger Games, but they're starting to expand. They're becoming epic. They're becoming almost social commentary that is appropriate in our modern world. You know, I've always thought that science fiction and fantasy is the perfect place to explore the troubles and questions of our modern world. And Mockingjay does that.
Just tell him the truth. Plutarch wants it televised.
I'm a huge, huge Game of Thrones fan. And when I found out I was going to be working with her, I was so excited. And every day I would ask her questions about Game of Thrones and what's coming up. And she was so patient and so giving, and sat down and talked to us and would talk to us about Thrones and what everybody was like and what the story was like.
We need to stop viewing each other as enemies.
You know, the bottom line with all of the actors involved in these films is that not a lot of nonsense brought to the table. Everyone really kind of looks into each other's eyes and says, you know, we're in a pretty cool place here. Let's enjoy it.
And we've really spent a lot of time together. But we have, like, great camaraderie. There's a great spirit. And that really sincerely starts with Jennifer, Woody, Francis, the folks who have really been here for a while.
You don't want to get that on camera. Digging in your butt.
And we laugh a lot. We play a lot. But as soon as Francis or Chris calls action, it's all business. We're all there to tell this story. We realize how big and important this franchise and these films and the story is to the audience. And we take it very seriously when we're between action and cut. But after that, we're all kind of like playing around and joking and really having a good time. And I think you have to do that over the course of that amount of time.
Mahershala is just, dude, an incredible actor to work with, man. His presence, I mean, it comes across, like you'll see it, you know, in the movie, but you know, that doesn't happen with everybody in real life. You know, sometimes they have a presence on screen that they don't have in real life, but Mahershala has that same presence in real life, man. And he is just super kind and really, really great at his job.
That's a nice one. The colors are lovely, of course.
It's very important to me, this series of films, when I originally looked at the script, because I wasn't offered it. It was just given to me because my agents know how much I like to read scripts, and there's no one else that I have played four times. And to have a character that is defined by Francis Lawrence and Gary Ross, by Suzanne Collins, it's really an extraordinary experience.
Donald's really great, and Donald loves this character, and Donald really gets the character. And one of the things that really interested me is the idea of a character like Snow sitting, you know, in the throne of power in the Capitol, knowing that the Capitol is falling. And it made for some, you know, really interesting scenes with him.
Antonius, with our best troops crushed in the mountains, what did we celebrate?
The death of the Mockingjay, sir.
I really liked Donald Sutherland, and I thought, I just gotta just be really cool around him. We shook each other's hands, and that's how we started. It's one of those feelings you realize you belong, and you're gonna play ball with that person you're gonna act with. And when they trust that you do that, like they do, then things are magical.
What did you say?
Shall I call for your doctor? I have to say, I was a little shy for the first week. I could barely talk to him, and that served my character. That was fine. When I was standing beside him, I literally felt like his minion. In a way, I am. And it was great to just work with him and be with him.
The arena has moved underground.
One of the common threads that was running throughout 95% of the characters is a strength. We were always drawn towards actors who really have strength, who you believe, who you would follow. And in Mockingjay, there's so many military leaders.
Mockingjay was one of those delightful little surprises that just sort of fell from the sky. I just woke up one day and my manager rang and said, would you like to go off and play in the Hunger Games? And I said, absolutely. I don't know how it happened. I didn't ask, but it was just out of the blue. I'm Lieutenant Jackson, and I want to introduce you to your squad. Francis and I didn't have any lengthy conversations. Coming into it later at the end of the story, I just kept my eyes open and kept my ears open and just really tried to be a part of the story, this train that was already really quite moving along.
This is the NUP, the Capitol's headquarters for all offensive operations.
Nina Jacobson sent me an email and she said, what about, you know, can you look into Gwendoline Christie? And said, you know, it was Cameron's idea. It was Francis Lawrence's assistant's idea. And I said, I had to email him, like, good on you. Excellent call.
I was asking about this character of Commander Nine, and I realized that this was a woman that had competed in a previous unseen Hunger Games, that had now led rebels and led a mass of people well.
We took heavy losses.
And then we had to work quite extensively on my American accent and to try and find that naturalness so that you weren't necessarily listening to an accent, you're the person's coming across.
Shut the door. No, Katniss, it's okay.
We auditioned actors and actresses for Tigress, and we were always looking for a certain look before the prosthetics, and she really stood out.
I was cast, but you have to also remember they held my announcement for several months. But I had stopped acting. And I have an extraordinary agent who believes in me and saw this role and thought I was right for it. And she convinced the casting director to look at my tape. She looked at my tape, and immediately I got a callback. The best callback I've ever had. I walked in the room, and Frances was smiling like a Cheshire cat. A week later, I got a phone call from my agent saying that I'd booked it.
It's great to be back, part of the Hunger Games again, and seeing the same characters, the same actors, the same director. Some changes, but it just feels the same, but completely different. Picked up right where I left off, the same jokes, same thing. Just great to see everyone.
Every day, this incredible energy of making this happen and work and working together and this collaborative team effort and joyful team effort to make this exquisite thing happen.
You know, the best ensembles and the best situations that you want to find yourself in, you know, as an actor is, you know, not dealing with the dumb stuff, you know, but just getting on with it in storytelling and, you know, and playing together as, you know, as actors. And so that's what we've all tried to do here, you know, and serve the interests of these stories that are revered by, you know, millions of fans around the world. So, you know, not a bad place to find yourself.
If everyone's having a good time, then I think it feeds through to the film. That's a wonderful work environment to be in.
I think the thing that was exciting for us coming onto the project is just that Mockingjay is so different from the last two films.
And it's really a war film. We started out with a lot of B units, so we started out with a lot of the rebels and the rebelling and these massive numbers of extras kind of right off the bat. And, you know, in the midst of that, we were also starting with our principals.
We've had different designers, costume designers on each of the three books. We have had the same makeup, same production design, but there's a very important relationship between costume design, makeup, and production design. And Kurt and Bart stepped in to it. They understood exactly what had already been done, what they were inheriting. But they built on that, added to that, and as the stories moved into a new world and the capital, they were able to have some space and room for their own new contribution and creativity. And yet have it be connected with what had been done before them, so it's not sticking out like it's a whole nother vision.
Collaborating with our amazing makeup team was awesome. It was fun to be able to bounce ideas off with all of them.
And plus, I mean, V has the vocabulary from the other film.
Absolutely.
You know, so, I mean, coming into that, you know, she has experience with most all these characters.
In Mockingjay 2, Katniss starts it, she wakes up and she's got bruises all over her neck and she's a lot worse for wear. She then goes into her more natural look again. She finally gets a little bit better, and no sooner is she healing up from her neck wound that she gets shot. So she now has a big, giant black bruise on her stomach, and she will eventually heal from that. Then she gets all wet and dirty from all the different stuff that happens. And then, of course, then she gets burnt, unfortunately, when her sister dies. She really gets the heck kicked out of her in this movie.
There were many versions of that makeup that we produced. A really severe burn makeup, a less severe burn makeup. We built on her life cast, but we pattern out on her face like this piece fits here. And if she wants to use a severe piece, it's this. If not, there's another piece that fits here that's less severe.
Don't, Katniss. The ointment's working.
This is Jennifer Lawrence. So these were some of the test patterns and just prototype sculptures that we were seeing if this was the level that they wanted. So some of them are more pronounced. Some of them are really kind of healed already. So we have different varieties and different stages of burn for her as well.
And we kind of just made it a modular set that allowed V on the day to adapt to Francis's liking.
Call out to the loyalists. You've seen what I can do. Yes, I have.
President Coyne, she had a really cool arc because, you know, she starts off as this leader of the people and then she slowly becomes more and more corrupt, which meant a transition in color.
It goes from this really dark, deep gray to charcoal to almost becoming this light dove gray by the end. And that was our way of bringing her closer to her becoming Snow.
When we see her in the second film, she has started to transform. So we wanted to subtly start altering her. She has just a little bit something more around her eyes, which gives her a little bit more definition. So by the end of two, when she's got her short hair and she's making her presidential speech, I put even more on her, but still not very much. It was something very specific that Frances wanted to make sure that we did very subtly.
I think all of us wanted to plot the evolution of District 13, and for me, of Coyne in particular, of going from someone who is of the people, the person who does wear a jumpsuit, you know, and looks like and is indistinguishable from anybody around her, to the person who becomes more and more militaristic. But it was very subtle.
Mockingjay, may your aim be as true as your heart is pure.
President Snow, clothing-wise, I do feel like Trish really did a great job with Snow in Catching Fire, and we just kind of continued the arc from that. But the thing I think is funny about Snow is, you know, all this can be going on around him. He just kind of lives in this bubble, in a way, and everything crumbling around him. But he still just looks impeccable, and that's kind of the most important thing.
If anything,
to him, in a way.
He kind of like becomes more glamorous, and as he starts to go down, you know, he looks good to the end.
With Joanna's look in this film, we really wanted to make it the best that it could be. And so, I mean, I sat with Frances. I was like, listen, I've shaved my head before. Let's do it. I'm ready. Like, let's go there. He was reticent because of the way that we were shooting it. It was going back and forth between having hair, having no hair.
We knew that we were going to be shooting at various times with her over the course of, you know, the 9-10 months we were shooting. I think Jenna maybe worked 5 days over the course of 10 months, and I just couldn't have her shave her. But there was a lot of work done to the bald cap.
Every day, that gave her like a 3-hour pre-call. So she really had to come in early, and we had to slick her hair down really, really tightly. And that's a whole process where it took two of us to really get the proper tension on her hair, to really get that hair slick, because it has to be perfectly, perfectly slick in order for the ball cap to work.
And rather than flocking her head, which would be applying little, tiny little bits of hair, they've just done the tiniest bit of airbrush on her head, so it looks as though she has a hairline.
She was like a real trooper. And then at night, the cleanup, you know, to get it all, take it all off, and we would wash her hair. She's a great, great lady, and she was a real trooper.
The wedding was awesome because we got to see that one nice moment, and we wanted Annie's dress to really look like something that was from her district.
There's this dress from the 30s that we found.
It was like kind of an organdy.
That we kind of sprung off of, and I mean, it's sheer and it's really beautiful, and there's a little bit of blue in the ruffle to add like this water thing. She's wearing pearls.
Every single bit of detail was handpicked by them and Frances, and they used this material which was like the same stuff that the nurses wore in District 13. It was an interesting choice that Frances made to make the dress something which would have been creative from what they had. I love it. It was incredible.
Finnick's suit was important to think of fabrics that might have come from their district. It's this beautiful, like, cotton.
It's like a heavy linen
thing that was dyed with vegetable dyes and all of that. And he
has on a really fine. Oh, he does kind of have on a half man kilt.
Yeah, half man kilt.
It was comfortable, but yeah, it was quite unfussy. Like they managed to piece together this amazing wedding suit, which was quite pompous as much as it could be in District 13. But simple. I think that's what District 13 is all about. It's about the simplicity of the nature of glamour. Like it's as glamorous as it can be, but without being over the top.
Why is Effie one of my favorite looks? Because she's been deconstructed a little, but she's managed to find herself. So she's had to assimilate somehow. And I think it's been incredibly challenging for her. And I think that when you see her look evolve, you see her evolving.
When we got to go back to the Capitol for Mockingjay Part 2, and the revolution has ended, and Effie gets to go back to, you know, a bit of her usual wardrobe, but everything became a little more toned down. You know, we were all very aware of how war impacts people's psychology, and so it's still very fabulous and over the top, but also in a weird way, toned down, simpler again. Everything's a little more simple.
I mean, makeup was really awesome. Like, they airbrushed that wig. The wig, we did it purple, but it didn't come out super purple. So I was like, can you guys help me out? V's like, yeah. Airbrushed it more purple, and it was perfect. All came together and worked out perfect.
Eugene is Tigress. She is amazing. She's like the perfect human being to be this character. Glenn and I worked very closely with Frances to make sure that this came out exactly the way Frances wanted it.
We started talking to V about it, and we started to have some illustrators do some ideas, and the idea was to sort of create a character who has augmented her face through tattooing, plastic surgery, and piercings. We started coming up with some designs, and then we started looking for actors that could wear it well and move well, and then we found Eugenie.
I had a meeting with Glenn. The first meeting was when he was doing a head cast. It creates a form of your face, and then they can build upon that.
We got her life cast, sculpted the character in a basic feline cat form, took that life cast, scanned it into a computer, and designed the tattoo patterns.
Well, here are all the temporary tattoos that we use for Tigress. First, the design came, and then Glenn broke it down in Photoshop and then pieced it out, and then we had to do multiple tests of, you know, how everything's gonna fit and how it's gonna lay, because, you know, there's so many planes on a face and everything, so.
Ultimately, that character, so extremely complicated, the plane of her face is the high surface, and then all of her tattoos are carved in just because we wanted to give it a different look, and within those scars, the tattooing occurs. And her whiskers came about as complete accident. At this point, Kurt and Bart's amazing sketches have started coming across my desk, and I kind of see what the wardrobe looks like. So in my head, I'm putting it together. So we wanted to try to help everyone else to see it more clearly. There's a tiny little nozzle tip within your airbrush, and this tiny little nozzle is about the right size to fit the gauge wire that we had. So I took the nozzle off of my airbrush, flipped it upside down, stuck it in the clay, and it actually works so well that in the final makeups, that is exactly what we ended up doing.
And it really came off really well. And the makeup's gorgeous. I mean, she has ears, she had teeth, she had fingernails for her, so she had these big, long claw fingernails. It took three of us to get her ready. There was a lot of her to be done.
Our approach was when the soldiers show up at her place, they basically wake her up. I love the idea of her throwing on this, you know, kimono-type sleep robe to answer the door, and, you know, maybe her whole hair thing wasn't in the best shape, so she would throw her hood up and be very, like, who is it? The silhouette, I think, that we created for her and stuff, she's one of my favorites.
By order of President Snow, all residents must proceed to the presidential estate.
Kurt and Bart didn't get to do some of the fun stuff that is, you know, designing the look of, you know, the capital, because we don't spend that much time there other than the refugees, certainly at the end of the last movie.
Costuming the capital refugees was really fun because from the beginning, I think when we were showing Frances some pictures of some refugees and these people who have the most excess, they're just grabbing all their fur coats and, you know, whatever it is they have.
And they're fleeing their homes. Some have been out all night partying, so you're seeing the remnants of what they look like when they left their homes, or, you know, they left their homes and couldn't get back. So it actually has nothing to do with their stature. It has to do with where they were physically when they all got evacuated.
Let's just start consolidating these boards so we can actually see what we got left, you know?
This might be a good torso for our burn girl over there.
Today we're shooting a scene where all the children get bombed at the Capitol.
In reach, we're reaching. Reach this parachute.
And quite a few injuries occur on some of the adults. You have some peacekeepers that get injured. Some of our refugees are capital refugees, and quite a few children. So we're starting to do the burn makeups on those injured people today.
Is anybody getting a full, something like that, do you think?
Well, we probably could have done it one of the peacekeepers for sure.
Okay.
But maybe we'll have somebody. Let's leave them out.
Okay.
We're basically focusing on the children that get injured. And of course, this is a scene where Prim also gets killed. It's a very disturbing scene, and we're trying to make it not as horrific as it would actually be, so we have to stay within our ratings.
I think that we have
some of the best makeup artists in the world working on this project. Last time on The Catching Fire, we had 45 to 50 makeup artists for maybe two-thirds the amount of people that we have. Today, we have 35 makeup artists for 1,000-plus people. And the kind of work that they're doing with the enthusiasm and the nonstop work and creativity is really mind-blowing, I have to say.
To see such a huge film come together was an amazing experience.
To be part of like such a huge franchise, actually, and to like be part of this, and it's just gotten bigger and bigger.
But also to take it to another place. It's not like doing the second film again or the first film again, but it was an amazing experience.
I really enjoyed working on all these films, meeting everybody. I watched the kids grow up on the show. I just loved being a part of it. We've made some great friendships, and I'm very happy to be involved in all these films. It was really, it was quite a journey.
We scheduled Mockingjay Part 1 and Mockingjay Part 2. You know, part of the efficiencies gained from shooting two movies back to back are, you know, if you've got a shared set, you do all of your scenes for both movies while you're there in that set, so you don't have to tear something down and rebuild it.
So, you know, the scripts are tight, and the scheduling of it was done in a very efficient way. So, in Atlanta, for example, we had most of, if not all of, the District 13 world.
The pieces of District 13 that were underground that we shot largely in Atlanta, whether that was in the first or the second movie, it was, you know, you had your locations for the underground area and those were what you were shooting. And whether they were having a big meeting in the first movie, in the second movie, didn't matter so much. When you get to some of the spectacle, the complexity of trying to balance the pre-production of this European movie that would shoot in Paris and Berlin and the production of this very daunting movie in Atlanta, which was made also during a ridiculous winter where we had snow in Atlanta. It was incredibly demanding.
It was cool. I mean, I think that, you know, also to Nina and John's and Francis's, you know, benefit, they were like, let's get out of Atlanta. You know, let's give this crew a treat, because honestly, it was the nicest thing in the universe to take that family on a European road trip.
I really love Atlanta. I think it's a great city, but we shot a long time there, so it was nice to get a break.
The good thing was we knew what Atlanta had. We'd already done a movie there. So we kind of knew, without a lot of additional prep, what we were going to get from Atlanta. So we kind of knew what the missing pieces were, and that was where Berlin and Paris kind of were filling in the gaps.
One of the reasons we also ended up in Paris and Berlin for Mockingjay 2 was to really find real locations and not create all of this stuff in CG, because then you just end up in a world of artifice, you know? It just doesn't look real anymore. It's just all fake, and I think it's much harder for an audience to get into a story that way.
So there's a few places in Paris and a few places in Berlin that had the right feel and architecture and were large enough where we could do a lot, you know, with real space.
Getting to shoot in Paris and Berlin, we went to the most interesting places. We had such insane sets.
And it was cool because these locations that we shot at were relatively unshown before in cinema, so it was good to have like a fresh new location to show audiences, and I think it added a lot to the experience for the audience.
Turn your weapons to the Capitol.
When we were first in Europe, our first 3 weeks was at this amazing chateau.
For Snow's Palace in Catching Fire. We chose the Swan House because we needed an exterior place to throw a party, and we had a couple of interiors, and it did the trick. But we knew going into these movies we were gonna need more, especially for Mockingjay Part 2. And we knew, just from having scoured the first time around, that there really wasn't anything else in Atlanta. So one of the reasons that we went to Europe was for more Snow Palace. And one of our scouts and Phil, our designer, found a chateau that was about an hour outside of Paris that actually had a very similar architecture to the Swan House, but much more scope and scale and much more land so we could really sort of expand on the interior of Snow's palace and some of the exteriors.
Pan Am is this other world, right? It's this dystopian society. You know, it's like the future, and you don't really know, going from Atlanta, Paris to Berlin, you don't know, which is what I love about it. You won't know in the film, oh, yep, that was Atlanta. And then being in Paris at some count's estate, amazing, amazing houses.
I'm sorry, ma'am, can't let you pass.
Let her in, on my authority.
She has a right to anything behind that door.
And in Paris, she kind of juxtaposed that sort of opulence, that idea of being in a villa, of being in a place where only the very, very wealthy have access to, and shooting in there, and feeling how different that felt to the world that we'd created in 13. Because then you see Coyne walk into that room that had been Snow's conference room and take ownership of it. You know, so here she is. She's gone from being underground in a janitor outfit to wearing a cape and kind of commanding a palace.
Got one more.
We really got to be like in these different spaces that really felt like Pan Am.
We're a vital part of the democracy that follows our victory.
You got it.
We found a couple of fantastic locations in Paris. These great buildings, apartment complexes that were done between the 60s and the 80s that we ended up using for different parts of our journey through the capital.
These housing projects in Paris, which look like an outdoor museum in some way, shape, or form, but you're like, these are the projects? This is unbelievable. And you go inside and you believe it, like when you go inside some of the buildings.
We knew the oil was a big moment in the book, so we found this great place in Paris, 10 or 12 miles east of the city, called Abraxas, that happened to be almost entirely enclosed.
It's just this incredible building that literally looks like something out of, you know, Suzanne Collins' book. I mean, it's incredible. It was amazing to be able to be in these places and feel the scale of them.
And that's where the battle takes place and what have you, and where we lose Boggs. So we spent quite a bit of time there.
Don't stop.
Ready, and go!
Squeeze his legs as hard as you can.
It's okay.
Mahalo. Mahalo.
And we thought, okay, well, this will be a perfect spot to do the oil. I mean, A, it looks great, but also, you know, our characters can sort of get down in the center, and if you close up very few little spots, it's suddenly this big bowl, right? So you can have the oil kind of pour down into it. Whereas if you were just out in open streets, the oil wouldn't do much. It would just sort of, you know, spread out, and it wouldn't take much to get up high.
The scale is correct. You can imagine the oil being kept up in the high sections of the apartments here, and that, you know, just by gravity, you could dump it and release it just like a big dump tank of water, and it would actually have a scary amount of energy and impulsion to it.
I'm always excited to get to shoot in Paris and Berlin. I mean, Berlin in particular I thought was fascinating because we were using these actual locations that were, you know, reminiscent of war.
We were using spaces, for example, Tempelhof, which was an airport that was designed largely and built largely under the Third Reich. You have these structures within it and these rooms within it of just an incredibly massive scale, and also deteriorated and patinaed to an extent that make for really wonderful, wonderful cinema.
Welcome to District 2. I'm Corporal Holmes. You can follow me, please.
And to kind of be in that location and feel the sense of, you know, what had happened there, of an actual war.
Don't worry, just how the loyalists say good morning.
And how the sort of history and the architecture sort of inform what we're doing, you know, is pretty impressive as well.
I mean, there is a lot of parallels or similarities to the story, to the building that was originally built by Hitler and a totalitarian regime. So there's a big parallel, and it's an impressive building. I mean, it's huge. You come into that airfield and you're just like, yeah, this is the scale that we need.
Ah,
And again, that's something that you cannot get by building it in CG or by making it look futuristic, or it's just real.
It added such a scale to it, it was clearly the right choice. It's abandoned right now, used for event space, believe it or not. And the airfield is all like rollerblading and bike parks and kite flying. It's really kind of amazing what a place like that could kind of turn into.
There was actually a really funny day where the whole neighborhood had apparently taken on this vote of, do we destroy this building and build and make something new, or do we keep it as kind of a historical monument? And the vote was to keep it as a historical monument. But then a week later, we had created, you know, basically a demolition site, a fake demolition site. And so the whole neighborhood went crazy, thinking that they were tearing the building down.
Just keep your eyes open. For bombed out capital, we found this old military base, a Soviet military base outside of Berlin. It was housing that really gave us like a great infrastructure of reality for our kids to walk through. We could do whatever we want to. It was gonna be knocked down. It was a total find. We blew holes through buildings, made them look like they were burned out. We added broken concrete to a lot of them, constructed a little kind of blown out cafe where our kids hole up for a couple of days.
I think for actors too, I think it makes it, you know, like I said, it makes it that little bit more real. And, you know, you don't have to imagine how it's gonna be. You can, you know, you can put yourself in that scenario.
451 to base, got a truck coming in from the south, over.
They were storage and barracks for the Nazi army. And then it was taken over by the Soviets after the war. And now it's just been deserted. And so all of these military barracks are just sitting there with trees growing in them and abandoned.
Since then, it's been completely like planed and landscaped, and it's got hardscape in it now. So it looks like a city street now. It's an amazing transformation.
Caster? Hold it. Pollock's tighter. Okay.
We sort of like this idea that, you know, the Capitol had been placing sort of pods, you know, in and around the city in an attempt for its defense. But what I really like is this idea that Snow sort of sees this opportunity, knowing that he's going to go down anyway, right, of being able to sort of televise this defense system against the rebels, and that they're gonna have to pay for every inch that they take with blood, and then he's gonna turn it into entertainment.
The arena shifted from the jungle to an urban landscape. We had to find one that was just as spectacular, but in a completely different way. So that was where the combination of Paris and Germany came from, a lot of research, a lot of amazing architecture that was discovered by Phil Messina.
Phil's found great locations that we've been able to magnify, you know, change the scale of, and make feel more Pan Am-like. But there's a lot of variety with the different locations we have. Because they're actual huge locations, there's a lot of great scale to them.
I mean, the thing that it gives you shooting in locations like Paris and Berlin is it gives you a real location. It gives you a real building. It gives you real walls that have stood there for hundreds of years and that have the right patina, the right wear and tear, you know? And it's like, sets can be built, but in that scale, you can't, you know? When you're shooting at a location like Chateau Voisin, you just can't build that. Either in CG or you know, Phil Messina couldn't build that kind of scale, and the same with the interiors, and it just feels real, you know? I mean, you can enhance it, you can, you know, Phil and his team, they brought a lot of extra stuff to it. I mean, they put a lot of work and time and, you know, to make it part of the movie, but there is something about shooting in a real location, you just can't do it in CG.
You know, there probably were easier, simpler, cheaper ways to shoot the Capitol and the other things that we found in Paris and Berlin, but the most extraordinary way to shoot the finale and to capture that world was to go to Paris and Berlin, and that's what we wanted to deliver.
Hey,
challenge for the show was that we prepped the first one because we had prep time, but we never really stopped and prepped the second one. So we had to do that while we were shooting. And that wasn't always because we were just talking about explosions. It was a lot about how do you portray the explosion since now the scale is so big? How do you still make it intimate enough? And about the group that we're following. So in that sense, it was more like a war film because, you know, they were almost on a covert mission and trying to travel through a war zone. It's funny, because for me, what I'm going to think of as an effects victory isn't, some people won't even know that it's effects.
3, 2, 1, 5.
We do so much more than just explosions, but basically when you say effects, that's what everyone thinks of. But, you know, there's a lot of, you know, the atmosphere and then the rain and the wind and the fire and the smoke and a lot of, like, things that should seem seamless, you know, elevators that have to run up and down that are on sets that wouldn't allow for an elevator. That happens all the time. And in one, we dealt mostly with sort of the mechanics of living in a mine and having elevators and feeling encapsulated. We got to venture out onto and do more of the journey. So effects-wise, there was more payoff in conventional effects in two than in one.
Part two is very intense, start to finish. Very action-packed. I think there's threats from all angles. I feel like part one is talking about the battle. This is, you're in the battle the whole time, pretty much, and you really feel like that at any moment it could be attacked or shot or exploded. Or, you know, it's there's threats nonstop through this.
Got a pod. Stay covered.
And so now the rebels have to go into the city that's been booby-trapped with all these, you know, elaborate game maker style traps and devices.
They're triggered by motion sensors or whatever, and they have a plethora of deadly consequences that they release.
Up to this point, it's been kind of fun and games for them. It's been exciting, but no real consequences. You know, it's supposed to be a pretty safe mission. But then Boggs ends up stepping on what amounts to a landmine and loses his legs. And from that moment on, it's very real for these characters.
Folks, we're going to rehearse Boggs' death, but we'd like to sweep the set. We'd like to sweep everybody out and have a private rehearsal.
Ready, and go!
Sequentially, the pod goes off, he loses his legs, which sets off another pod, which brings toxic oil that comes in to fill the square, and they run from that.
And here comes the wave.
Go! Move out!
Go, grab her, let's go!
Move out!
We've got to catch her up to you.
There's a moment where Peeta relapses and attacks Katniss and tries to bash her in with a rifle, so that was another fun interaction with mixing the actors with the stunt double. And we get away with a lot on these films because Renee Moneymaker looks that close, both in the way she moves and the way she acts and the way she looks. It's an amazing asset for a film, especially for the action department. Stunt people have to act too. You're the physical kind of embodiment of that character. And I think Renee does a great job of embodying the movement and feeling that Jennifer brings to Katniss. And so together, they are Katniss Everdeen.
Yeah, definitely, you know, when you're doubling somebody, you want to be able to move like them. Sometimes I just observe her or observe her mannerisms, which is actually really weird because then I'll just kind of do something with her mannerisms, not trying to, and I'll be like, whoa, that was weird. But yeah, it definitely helps on camera to be able to pick up those things because it definitely reads. It just makes it a better match.
Renee has been my stunt double since the first Hunger Games. She's absolutely incredible. I'm so lucky. She's an amazing choreographer, and she's an amazing teacher. And she's also a great just body double, so I get to go home early sometimes. She is definitely the action part of Katniss. She's the action hero element of Katniss.
Because Renee looks so much like her, and because of the magic that Charlie and visual effects can kind of work with face replacement or just little alterations, we were able to shoot the action in such a way that you didn't have to cut around for a double. You just kind of shoot with Renee coming right at you. And, you know, if you're just catching a glimpse of the face or it's something they can alter, it's Katniss Everdeen. Even though it's Renee Moneymaker, it's still Katniss Everdeen. And then you go in for the close-up where it's Jennifer, and you know, it's seamless the way those two work. And I have, you know, from a distance been like, is that Renee or Jennifer? I don't have my glasses on, I can't tell. So their interaction with Peeta, Mitchell tries to intervene, he gets knocked back and gets pulled up in a barbed net. We wanted, again, to do as much as we could practically. So we set up in Atlanta to test this stunt where we have a guy fall and get yanked, get spun up in this net. We ran a couple tests and we'd shoot him and show Francis, and it just never had the kind of velocity or the violence that he wanted. And we had a limited amount of time in the location where we were. So we opted for a digital takeover, which we would start the lift and he would do this, you know, cool spin on a cable. But then for the rest of it, when he's getting wrapped up and really violently kind of torn about, visual effects would take over.
Everdeen,
keep it all up. Everdeen. Come on, let's go.
Boggs gave it to me.
This is the Hollow, which there's many versions of. This came almost completely out of Phil Messina's head. In the book and in the movie, it does a multiple tasks. So it was really difficult to come up with a design that looked like it could accomplish all of that. The Hollow, what it's supposed to do is be like a futuristic GPS that also shows them where the capital has placed pods. So it has some sensors in it as well. So there's probably four different versions that have different functions. This particular one is for a projector, it projects a 3D image. So there's a piece here opens and you end up with a lamp that then they create visually the 3D image off of this. So this version is like a projector.
Even with the Hollow, it's likely that new pods have been set. Whatever they contain, they're meant to kill you.
The weapons in Mockingjay 1 and 2 are, it's the next generation of weapons that we've seen, the progression of them in these films. And Drew Petrada and his prop department are amazing, not only in the design, but in the building of practical weapons that the stunt department can use. Because we use them and abuse them. We broke a lot of tridents. We put a lot of strain on the bows. We put them through the paces.
Finnick?
This is Finnick's new trident. This is the trident BD made for Finnick. One of the things that we wanted to do is, because of the amount of action that are in this movie and that they're military and running around, that it be a little bit more compact. So for ease of carry and made a little bit more sense. But it also has the ability to expand digitally into the same size of the trident he used in Catching Fire. So this one also expands and opens to change the shape quite a bit. And it's a nasty looking weapon. And we kept thinking about the action in the movie and how difficult it would be to deal with. So by making it collapsible like this, it does give it's a lot slimmer design, and he can do a lot more action, a lot simpler, and it makes more practical sense than running around with something that's spread out like that all the time. So R.A. Rondell and Sam Hargrave and I started playing with how Finnick would fight with this. I think the first time Sam grabbed it, he did one of these, which just kind of popped it open. It turned out by accident, but it turned out to be a really cool move, and Sam looks really cool doing it.
And so that lended a very dramatic feel to the weapon and a dramatic way to introduce it in the tunnels when we kind of lose track of Finnick for a while and we're not sure if he's made it. His reintroduction to that scene is via his weapon.
Do you know what? I was really quite jealous, though. I spent the entire filming of Mockingjay Part 2 very, very bitter. Purely because all the other guys got machine guns and I got a trident. I was like, I'm gonna be no use to you from like 100 yards out. I can throw it and it's gone. I'm lost, I'm left with nothing. The other guys have machine guns and everything, you know, but I made the most of it. I only hit myself in the head like once or twice and only hit other people about once or twice. I spent hours and hours with broom handles and anything I could find that was even slightly similar to a trident. I had an incredible team of people kind of helping me get adept to it, you know, to sort of make it as if it was like a fifth limb. And, you know, I can only say kind of thank you to them, really, for making it look seamless.
Go, go, go!
All right, so here we are, day 3, inside the tunnel. They call this the Thunderdome. It's where we have all of our main characters. They're leading the assault on the Capitol. They're stuck in the sewers, and it's action time now. The mutts
have come in from each one of these holes around us into this Thunderdome where it's a battle royale and our heroes are kicking ass, but just barely.
The lizard sequence was really, really difficult. It was difficult to conceptualize. I mean, we had the general idea. You know, I tried storyboarding it, that didn't really work. We tried pre-vising it, that didn't really work. So eventually what I realized would work would be that I got Sam Hargrave, my, you know, stunt coordinator, to sit down with me, and I walked him through all the things that have to happen.
And so he presented it to us and said, hey, you know, from here on, it's your show, what do you think? These are certain beats that I want, and if you can hit those in your action, everything else is fair game. So we took that and kind of, you know, outlined it like you would a story, and we had our crew, our team, and we went through and just started working on the action that would support and logically lead to these story points.
You know what, I like that orientation too, because then we can, is that a good spot for him to be for the,
it's similar.
As long as it's good and it's gonna work.
Yeah.
But I actually like this orientation, so it's less similar to that.
Oh God, that was rough. We were in wet tunnels for about 2 weeks. It made the action a lot harder because all of our gear was waterlogged, so it was like an added 20 pounds. So that was very tough on Renee Moneymaker.
Okay, on action. Ready, and 3, 2, 1, action!
Basically, the lizard mutt has taken Katniss and tossed her, and this is the impact of that shot, so. I'm gonna run and clip the little catwalk and make big splash.
Mm-hmm. Try one more?
Mm-hmm. Get a little higher.
3, 2, 1, action!
It was a very physical shoot for me. The stunt team is incredible in these movies. Sam Hargrave and my personal stunt double, Ralph Cook. It was actually the hardest thing for me was the fact that I was handcuffed for so much of the movie. So all of my running was like this. So it was like, you feel a little bit off balance sometimes. Even my fight scenes with like in the tunnels with the lizards and everything, my hands are cuffed for a lot of the choreographing and for that fight work and everything. So that's pretty challenging.
Action! When Finnick is hitting someone with his trident, there's really got to be something there for him to hit. He just can't mime that. So we've got our stunt team who are all dressed up with these dot markers all over them, so we can get their positions in space. So we're using witness cameras as well as the principal cameras to triangulate where they are. So when we replace them with our CG mutations, we can place them in the same place. It's really helpful to us to have them there because it means that we can have the actors actually interact with the stunt guys, and that means, you know, when they're being strangled or when they're like throwing each other around, they're not miming that, they're not sort of pretending to be strangled, they're actually, you know, being thrown around. And that adds a lot of life and vibrance and tension to the performance.
Special effects is fantastic. They've got fire, they got smoke, these like stirring the water. This water here is a mixture of the dye they use for Coca-Cola, and Dawn soap, and alfalfa to make it look like a sewer. And BK and Steve Fairman have done an amazing job. It's gross looking, yet kind of like a day at the spa.
Nice.
Yeah, it was intense. I had to sort of roll in and under this thing in knee-deep water and then come out up on top and then get tackled. I got punched in the face, legit one take, like got punched in the face. And then the next sort of thing, like he was meant to pretend to punch me in the face, but scratch my neck. And the next thing is like I sort of shoot it in the head and flip him over, and it was good. It was good fun.
But yeah, it was a very tiring, very physically challenging day, but a lot of fun. I mean, I think anyone that gets the opportunity to wield a trident, do it. It's fun. You will have a lot of fun.
All residents must proceed to the presidential estate.
From the moment Katniss and Gale leave Tigress' shop and head towards the capital, that was really our war movie. I say ours because Francis wanted his war movie, and then for us too, for the stunt department, it was a great opportunity to get our war movie.
Peacekeepers! Rebels! 50 cal!
And we shot that in Atlanta. The immediate surroundings were real. Phil built a set that was, very well put together. It's like a tangible feeling of the Capitol. Yet to expand that into the realm of the film is gonna be a lot of work from visual effects.
And boom!
Not bad.
So everybody worked long and hard to make this thing come to pass, the standout moments for me, there's a lot of standout moments, but the standout moment is that long shot where Gale and Katniss are, all hell has broken loose when the first shots are fired, and now they're in it. There's bullets whizzing overhead, bombs going off, people are going down, getting shot.
Actually filming the Capitol finale. We previously video vised this about a month ago, and now we're sticking pretty close to the layout that we shot, and although I think this is better, Francis has better shots than I come up with, but it's looking pretty close, pretty exciting. Lots of long shots with complicated action, and they're all knocking it out of the park. When the time is right, this truck over here, gonna blow it sky high.
Bang, bang, bang!
Woo! There's gonna be a big bomb underneath of it, and an RPG is gonna set off, and they've got a crane that's gonna yank that puppy into the sky and then drop it down again. That's gonna be exciting.
Flipping the truck was fun. The thing weighed 16, 17,000 pounds. It was a real truck. It was a real driving truck. Those tires, you can see the tires are just about as tall as I am. We did it with flipping it, with dropping weights. With a cable on the back end of it. You had a little bit of a pyro kicker, a little shock and mortar at the beginning of it with Sam. And then burning gasoline, which is always fun. Who doesn't like burning, setting gasoline on fire? It was a big sequence. There's a lot of stuff going on. People dying, trucks flipping, stunt guys jumping off of a 40, 45 foot tall balcony. I thought it came out great.
And 3, 2, 1, action!
Fire.
Whenever you have, hundreds of people in the background with stunts and camera, it's always complicated to get everything working, especially in long shots like this. But I think we've got a great crew of folks, great stunt people, great leader in Francis Lawrence, and all of our, all the players are doing great, so it's coming together.
This is my fourth movie with Alan, and we had Mark on here as well. Jen has been around for all of those movies. The earlier ones as an assistant editor, and then she sort of moved up and started cutting some scenes. She really primarily cut one of my favorite scenes in Mockingjay Part 2, which is the vote at the end.
And I vote yes. For Prim.
Finishing this movie, we've had much more breathing room than any of the other two movies that I did in the series.
unlike Mockingjay 1, we won't work right up until the release. We'll probably finish Mockingjay 2 sometime in the summer.
Mr. Heavensbee.
Just like with everything Francis does, he's so ahead, he's so well prepared, and he has such a great work ethic.
I know a lot of people use multiple editors and sort of make them compete almost in terms of scenes, like cutting the same scene and you sort of get to choose the one you like better. And this one was really a shared process and sort of individually working on reels and then sharing them and, you know, and we got a lot done very quickly.
Mark and I really focused on MJ1 during shooting because we had a tighter schedule. And then Jennifer focused on MJ2. And so then if there was free time, then Mark and Jennifer would divide MJ2. And I really didn't do a whole lot of editing on MJ2 until after we had come close to finishing MJ1. I mean, I'd cut some of the action sequences and stuff, but that's kind of how we divided it.
Together with Mark, I'd say he was really coming back and forth on it quite a bit. But it was really wonderful because we could do scenes as they came in and send them over to, usually I would show them to Mark and to Alan and then Francis. And, you know, he would look at it occasionally, but even Francis's energy was mostly on MJ1 at that point. Everybody was kind of focusing on getting through that.
Mockingjay Part 1 came out. We went down for a little while. We came back. It's now the beginning of the year. And so, you know, we've had the bulk of a year to kind of go through and work on this movie.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 76th Hunger Games.
Inherently, both of them had a different feel because MJ1 was so much underground, and it was from Katniss's point of view specifically, and it had that bunker feeling. And Part 2, it's really boots on the ground and getting out there and the real war that's happening.
It's huge. Big world building, huge character animation sequences, lots of explosions and fluid dynamics. Fortunately, we have enough time to complete the effects properly on this movie. We turned over a lot of those sequences very, very early. Some of the sequences we turned over before we'd even completed MJ1. You know, schedules are tight in the effects world, so better to do it early than to wait and be rushing.
As much as possible, we try and shoot as much as we can real and live. But even then, there's always the opening down at the end of the street that needs to be extended, or the buildings that need to be extended vertically beyond what we actually have. There's always something. And so DNEG and MPC have done a great job in this of sort of doing those digital set extensions.
On the most basic level, I see it as a great craft project for us and for all the visual effects people, the hundreds that will be working on it, because we're really finessing ideas and concepts to help suit the story.
I knew the scope of the work in this last film was going to be huge. You know, having spent such a long time in the trenches with the crew, shooting all this stuff, I was most excited about seeing it all come together. When you shoot two movies at the same time, there's a lot of time between when you shoot it and you get around to doing the second movie. So we had a long time to think about it. And because of that, the expectations were really, really high.
The biggest scenes that we worked on was the scene following Katniss as she approaches District 2, which is the location of the Nut. We follow Katniss as she arrives at District 2 on a hovercraft, which was computer generated. This is a scene that challenged us in many ways, from creating beautiful establisher shots that define District 2 and the tone of District 2, both this airport and seeing the Capitol on the horizon, which was just captured by the rebels the previous night. So it's kind of a war-torn battle. They've seized it. Peacekeepers have held up in the Nut. We had to create entire CG environments, hovercrafts as they land, smoke, and all of the things that go into a shot like that. So it was a full spectrum. That sequence resonates with me because it really represents the wide variety of work that we did on all of Mockingjay. We then later jumped to a train station after the attack, when the rebels have now essentially buried the Nut and there's only one way out, and they're at the train station to allow people to escape.
This is Katniss Everdeen, speaking to all of the loyalists from the heart of District 2.
Survivors, inbound!
Well, Jennifer took the first pass at that, and so I remember coming in and thinking that there's gonna be a lot to deal with, so why don't we have Jennifer work on this?
There was an infinite number of ways you could do it. I mean, the thing with that scene, as I recall, the takes were really long. The setups would go from the very beginning to the end. Everybody was moving from one side of the set to the other. And that was really kind of flooring. You know, like those close-ups would start at the beginning and then they would take you all the way through to her speech at the end and her finally getting shot.
Why are you fighting the rebels? Your neighbors. Your family.
The performances in that were just so amazing. That's the thing, is that she delivered that monologue, you know, with so many subtle variations, and they were all so good.
We all have one enemy, and that's snow.
I remember really struggling to decide which one would be the best, because you could take the worst one and it was still great. There was no worst one.
He turns the best of us against each other. Stop killing for him!
I remember them when the first, the location is called the Braxis, but where the toxic oil comes in and Boggs' death and all of that starts coming in, I was thinking, where did they find this place, you know? And then to play out that whole scene, you know, it was blocked just, you know, very dramatically there, but it felt like they were trapped.
Got a pod. Split take cover.
For the toxic oil sequence, it was filmed in an actual location in France with a lot of trees. So the sort of less glamorous work straight away was reproducing that environment so that it didn't have the sort of foliage, and then started to move toward the dystopian setting for the film.
We actually rebuilt that in CG, because then we had to damage it and we had to then cover it in oil. So you have something that is present in the real world and you're completely changing it to look how you need it to in the film.
We can't actually chip away at the cement and, you know, make it look like bullets have been flying everywhere. And so we've done a lot of that kind of damage manipulation in post as well.
Each segment of our work had one or two extremely challenging shots. As a whole, the toxic oil sequence was a bigger scope of work in some ways. It was certainly technically really difficult. You know, we had a very small crew.
The good thing was, it's nothing that we hadn't done before. So we did water sims and fluid sims at DNEG quite a few times before. But then it was just such a large scale. For some of the sims, like the massive ones, they took 20 hours to 2 days or so just to sim the shot. And the amount of detail that we needed, so we had to run very high resolution simulations. The heaviest one, I think, were about 250 million points that we simulated, little particles that we then would mesh, surface them, and then render them.
Let's go, soldier!
When we work with a viscous liquid, it tends to miniaturize, it tends to feel smaller. There's a version where it looks like water. That's exciting, but, you know, not different. And there's a version where it looks like chocolate, you know, that might seem a little tame or friendly. You know, so it's finding the right formula that tells you scale and feels right and flows properly, and has the right physics, but feels like something different.
So this is where Mitchell gets thrown into the oil. Biggest challenge with this shot is getting the interaction between him and the CG oil. There's him hitting the oil, but there's also the trap as well. He triggers it as he falls in, and then all these wires and everything start to... The only thing that really reads is all the reflections in the black oil, so I suppose you've got to be selective where, you know, these lines come out and sort of, and pass over.
Come on, we gotta move!
Get inside!
Everybody inside, go!
As a compositor, that was a challenge because you had these characters in this environment that was very bright, almost white, and the toxic oil is almost black, and putting these characters into this environment was very challenging because you really do have to change a lot of what is around them.
As the oil dries, everything gets caked in oil and there's stalactites dripping off things, and it goes from being a very fluid thing to a very rigid thing as it collapses and there's dust and all that sort of jazz.
The dried oil, it sets to this sort of hard black, sort of plasticky coating, but it can't just be black and shiny, and it can't just be black and matte. It has to be very detailed. And that was really, really hard because all the dried oil in the movie is digital.
For this sequence, we found an oil that looked pretty much like the oil in a dried oil scene. And we made some tests with splashing the oil in different materials, in plastic and dirt and...
seeing how it reacts,
yes,
how it dries.
Yes, how it reacts. And we tried to use to play with different materials and let it dry. And that's how we did.
It's like an artist trying to find a way how it looks plausible and how it looks convincing. It wasn't supposed to be actually like tar, but more like black paint that's dried. So it had to also look technically a bit futuristic and not like an environment catastrophe in a way.
Dorothy was hugely involved in the sculpting. I mean, literally sculpting. They call them stalactites, but it's like the dripping, you know, hardened oil and things like that. That's been one of the biggest challenges of the film.
When they come out of the apartment steps and they walk across the arena, we shot the plates for this without any green screen, without any blue screen. They were just in the environment. And so to composite our CG environment behind them, tracking and rotoscope and painting all those edges, that was some of the hardest shots I've ever done in my career, I have to say. The artists really knocked that one out of the park, I think.
With music, you know, we had Phil Tallman was our temp music editor. And then with James, you know, we're giving him cuts very, very early on, and he's sending back demos. And he's sending us back demos in 5.1. So, you know, we're able to play the movie in a relatively semi-finished sounding state.
Scoring is one of my favorite parts of a movie. It's great to hear the orchestra play. But it was interesting on this because, you know, my third movie with James in the series, you know, there's so much music and so many themes already built in. And to have that pool to pull from is so great. It makes the process of music a little easier. There's less sort of trial and error, you know, because there's more to pull from in such a, you know, inherent knowledge of the series and the characters and the themes. We decided not to record at Air in London this time, but to go to Abbey Road. And I love Air, so I was sort of unsure, but also excited because I'd never been to Abbey Road. And really great to go down to Studio One and be there with the orchestra. We had the same orchestra as we've had in the last two movies, and they did a phenomenal job. And you know, you just feel the history in that building.
The peacekeepers drive in their trucks. We are in the apartment looking across the arena at the apartment that the leagues are hiding in, and the peacekeepers fire a rocket-propelled grenade at the apartment, and the whole thing pancakes, which is all digital. That's all us.
Part of the plate here, and you can see they've got these big cannons that they'd set up that fires these plumes of dust. I'm not quite sure what that is. But that was a good point of reference for us to replicate kind of a dusty, smoky explosion. And there's two layers there. There's like the kind of pyroclastic smoke that's coming from things burning, as well as the layers of dust.
The hardest thing was probably getting a correct sense of scale into those pieces and structural integrity as you fracture that building. Do the pieces look too small? Do they look like tiny bits of gravel? Do they look like huge boulders? And does it look like it's held together with steel? All the stairwells and the internal floors and the furniture that's all in there. And it's all rigged up to explode and fall according to physics.
As a comper, we're tasked with trying to integrate everything to make it look as real as possible. So I was looking at a lot of buildings falling, a lot of fireballs, and what they do in nature, I guess you would say. Yeah, so I take Phil's work and I make it look pretty.
Significantly good. Better, yeah.
Once we get into the sewers, it gets really interesting because it's not all about being, you know, loud and bombastic.
Goodness.
That was initially done in production while they were shooting. They got one of the assistants to record that voice, and we've since replaced it with a group actor, but trying to just get this voice saying her name in a whispered manner and just putting it way off in the tunnels. So you just barely hear it. Did I hear somebody say a word, or am I just hearing a weird sound? And that's when we have the opportunity to get super, super quiet in the tunnels. And then we're able to, you know, just hear little sounds here and there before it all just goes bananas, basically.
I guess the lizard sequence was a sequence that I worked a lot on early on just because it was huge. And it was a little bit different than the way it was prevised. So a lot of times you get action sequences and, you know, you get a previs and you kind of just sort of slot stuff in. But in this case, there was previs and then there was stunt vis, which the stunt group went and shot something similar with a few little props. And then what we ended up with was something sort of in between. So that was challenging, just figuring out exactly what that scene was going to be, and predominantly because I needed to do it before they wrapped the set. It was all those water tanks, and I was getting a lot of pressure from the producer, you know, get this thing cut, and, you know, we don't want to rebuild all that.
We'll go in and, you know, lay the creatures on top of those performances. In some cases, sometimes we'll create our own performances to make sure that we're not bound by what human performers can do. The characters, you know, they're not magical. They can't run around like Spider-Man. They can't, you know, climb upside down in the ceiling. They're sort of bound by the same rules we are, but they're extremely strong, fast, wiry, and they're sort of mad, you know, with hunger. I think it's gonna be pretty exciting.
The meat grinder, trying to find the mechanics of this element that's bursting through the floor in these successive waves. That's been a tricky thing, but trying to get the explosion of the cracking cement and the tile floor and all that kind of stuff, and as well as the pillars that explode basically as each wave comes forward. You know, I've done a lot of smashing of concrete and bricks and in order to do it.
When Katniss and Gale join up with the refugees who are making their way to Snow's mansion. There was a partial set built by Phil Messina, the production designer, which we used as a starting point. And we used his plans to build the environment of these particular blocks of the Capitol. The whole thing starts off with this big crane shot that goes up and above the checkpoint, and very little of that was built. All that environment is all digital.
First, we had to model it. We had to create a digital model of it, and then we broke it into small chunks. We had a lot of artists just working on it and simulating along, just create all the secondary stuff to make it really sit in the plate and make it look real.
What we can see here, this is the sort of low-res, low poly count version of that environment. That's the Snow's mansion, which is extended left and right by about 50%, which is then bolted onto our virtual set and our virtual environment, which links up into the Avenue of the Tributes.
All residents must proceed to the presidential stadium.
It starts off with everyone sort of peacefully walking to the gates. They think they're gonna have sanctuary in Snow's mansion. Then rebels hit suddenly. Checkpoint collapses, so there's all of that happening. And there's smoke billowing everywhere, so you have a CG explosion and smoke and fire and everything.
And action!
It helps that it was filmed in the way that it was filmed with a lot of people all together. It wasn't sort of one person filmed one at a time. Everybody was on a location outside under real sunlight. And I think when we have that kind of photography, it becomes very straightforward to generate computer images that sit with that. And then sort of getting all of the elements in with running down the street and trying to make it look frenetic, I think was quite challenging. But we did start from some really good photography.
That's a lot of guns. That's a lot of ricochets. That's a lot of bullet impacts. That's a lot of bullet buys. Visually, we see a lot of tracer fire going whizzing by, and it's associating a sound with all those things. In this movie, we have gun battles raging in sewer tunnels, in subway tunnels, subway platforms, and also up on the street. So there was a wide variety of things that needed to sound kind of acoustically correct. So we went out and did 2 days of recording. We did an urban setting to get the way a gun actually sounds in a cityscape. We went into a warehouse and did various locations to get this kind of size and scale of being inside as well. And then we did one day up in Big Bear in this nice canyon type area for all the close-up and, you know, exterior sounds. The sound of like a canyon having that, you know, wow, is way different than being on a city street when it's slapping off of buildings and, you know, got this flutter echo and this kind of cool city sound. So rather than try to recreate that in post and reverb and do all this kind of stuff, we thought, let's get the actual acoustical event and use that.
That truck flip, that was done through the special effects. They actually flipped the truck. So we were using different plates, marrying that in, also doing CG work there. The gun that you see that's firing wasn't on set. Francis thought it would make it more action if you could see that there's a reason why they were shooting that truck. It would seem like they were just shooting an unmanned truck that explodes sort of conveniently right next to Katniss and Gale. That was a really good addition. We added that in CG. And then the jack exploding, that's massive with the CG work. And then, of course, the parachutes coming down and all the mayhem that happens with the explosions and the different types of explosions.
Thank you.
Katniss gets blown back and she's on fire.
There was a very specific beat that Frances wanted to see her come through the fire.
We shot Renee Moneymaker, the stunt woman. We put her in a fireproof Katniss outfit and set her on fire.
Wrapping effects fire around a practical actor is quite challenging. It went from flying back in front of a green screen to it being held on Earth. She's enveloped by fire.
Which looked really good at the time, but then when we looked at the cut, when you compare it to all the fire that's around, it looked like a few little flames. And so we had to pretty much kind of cover her in digital fire in order to make that work.
For continuity as well, there was things that visually Frances wanted to see with sort of her POV of the smoke coming off of her and how sort of awful that is, but also beautiful at the same time. That last image that you see before it fades to black.
I feel very proud to have been a relatively small part in this. I mean, it's all down to the artists, really. The artists, their talent, and their ability to take on this amount of work.
I'm definitely proud of the work we did. It was challenging, and there were some late night shifts as well involved, of course, but I think the results are totally worth it.
I'm very proud to be a part of the creation of Mockingjay because it is so popular and everyone loves that aspect of it.
I was stoked because my sister is a huge fan of Hunger Games. She lives in Australia. I told her on Skype. I'm like, oh, next project, you know what to work on? I'm like, oh, Mockingjay 2. She's like, oh my God.
It's always good to work on a film with hype around it. It motivates you. I think you get excited to come to work and, you know
Absolutely.
That there are people out there looking forward to what you're putting out.
It's just nice to be able to have that journey from Catching Fire all the way through to the second Mockingjay and being able to see the end and finish with Frances and Charlie and Walter and the teams here. Being able to have Dean Egg be a part of this journey is really great.
I feel like I really got spoiled on these. I think forward and I'm like, I don't know what's ever going to compare with this experience. It's just been so amazing.
It's been very rewarding, making good friends. But as far as the series, it's also been wonderful to see how it reaches out, you know, and people respond, because I've never worked on anything that's had this global response.
The movies have a great message, and I think that they're going to withstand the test of time, because I'm very, very proud of my work and their work. And to be able to work together with these people has just meant so much to me.
The last week or two happened real fast. After 330 days, when you get down to the last 5 or 10, you just can't believe that, doesn't even register. It's a whole part of your life, you know, a chapter that's coming to a close.
What made it all work was how close we were and how much fun we could have with each other and how much, as much as you missed your family at home, you had this other family on set. And I think we definitely sort of supported each other through the laws of film and through, let's say, what was a very long shoot and not, it's hard to get through that much time without your family.
Well, Plutarch gave me a letter for you.
I don't want it.
You never make it easy, do you? Okay, I'll read it for you.
Katniss.
The sequence of Woody reading the letter, that scene ended up being the very last scene we shot in the movie during physical production. That was actually a scene with Philip Seymour Hoffman. So that was one of the two scenes that Phil was unable to do. And he wasn't going to read a letter. This was going to be a scene of him saying this to Katniss at the end. But of course, he died before we shot that scene. It was really interesting to shoot that because Phil wasn't there, but also because it's such an emotional scene near the end of the movie, to have that be the last thing you shoot, you know, after 155 days of shooting. Usually you're on some, you know, silly little insert or something, and here you are in this room with two of the key characters doing a pretty heavy scene. Made the end of shooting really emotional.
When the time is right, Commander Paler will pardon you. The country will find its peace. I hope you can find yours. Plutarch.
The reason that we went back was that we had always initially planned on shooting the scene in the field for the epilogue at the end of our schedule in Atlanta, because it was going to be spring and it would be one of the last things we do before we go to Europe. Because it's the last scene in the movie, I didn't want to do it up front, even though we were shooting in fall. So I wanted to shoot it then. But we had such a horrible winter in Atlanta with all these ice storms that we never got green again. And so because we knew it wasn't going to be green, and because we knew it was a scene for the second movie, we decided to kind of punt it for a year. So we figured it'll be a little sort of class reunion.
Well, it was really emotional. I mean, we went back to that field that we have been to for Catching Fire, that has been, you know, an iconic place in these stories, the place that Katniss said goodbye to Gale, and it had a very button-like feeling to it, to see these characters, sort of to send them off in this way.
Yeah.
It was really cool. It was great to be back in Atlanta, and my nephews played our babies. It was so special because these movies are such a giant chapter of my life, so to get to share that with my family is just unbelievable.
And Jinx, yeah, too.
He like woke up, he's like, what?
Oh, did you go back to your
Theo, my youngest nephew, played the baby, and waking him up was a feat. My four-year-old nephew was just, he loves Josh. Fell in love with Josh in Berlin when we were shooting, so he was just all over him, so that part was easy.
I knew what the epilogue was gonna be, obviously. Read the script, read the books and everything, but in my mind, I imagined that, oh, we have still more things to shoot, so we're gonna see everybody. And it wasn't. It was like just me and Jen and like her little nephews that played our children. And like I was imagining like Woody and Liam and everybody being there, but that's completely an unrealistic expectation because that's not always gonna happen. I remember my call time was like 3:30 in the morning, went out to shoot it, and then we were done by like 8 a.m. And then that was it, like that was the final shooting for all the Hunger Games. It was kind of like this sort of, whoa.
I do it over and over. It gets a little tedious after all these years. There are much worse games to play.
It was sort of a nice thing that we could all kind of come back together. It was so sort of quick and sort of fun, and it makes you wish that we were shooting more. But you know, I have to say the end of the initial shoot was far more emotional.
time is right, Commander Paler will pardon you. The country will find its peace. I hope you can find yours. Plutarch.
What now?
Home. We go home. I remember when we were doing the last setup, and I'm doing this thing, reading the letter to her, to Jen, and then and everybody's gathered around. Like Liam is there. He came in. You know, he wasn't working that day, and Josh was there, and you know, people are all gathered around. This is four movies we shot together. Like, you know, this is a family. You know. And I remember reading that, and then there's a pause, and Francis says, cut. And there's just a pause, because we know this is the last setup, and he goes, we got it. And then the first yells out, that's a wrap. And it was, you should have seen the, I mean, it was like a physical response people had to that because it was such a big deal.
So, folks, please, we'd like to invite you to the other room right down the hallway here for a glass of champagne. Before we officially call it for right.
I think everybody was really ready to go home because it was hard. But everybody really loves one another. And I think it was just that kind of, you know, like the last day of college or something where you realize everybody's going off to their other lives and you'll try to see each other, but you know you won't see each other as much as you'd like. And so it was an emotional time.
There's not enough words. I'm gonna try not to cry. There's not enough words to express the love and respect I feel for you guys. So I just can say thank you for caring so much about these stories and the characters, for being so good at what you do, because it would have been impossible to get through this without you guys. And most importantly, for being such an amazing family to me and to each other throughout this last year, because that's the most important thing of all. So cheers to you guys.
You know, it's been this very heightened, very gratifying, very emotionally resonant experience and a really tough act to follow. It's very hard to imagine having an experience like this ever again.
I do have to say a few things about Francis. I honestly cannot imagine anyone but you who could have pulled off shooting these three movies in 18 months. It has been a superhuman task, but once you had taken the reins, I knew there was no one else who could take your place. Your creative vision, your leadership, and your ability to bring out the best in everyone has allowed every member of this remarkable cast and crew to shine. We are all lucky to have been a part of a series that means so much to so many and says so much that needs to be said, but we are especially blessed to have gotten to do it.
Nina, I don't know what to say about your creativity, your generosity, your friendship. Your mom should be very proud of you. And your kids have the coolest mom in town. Thank you so much for inviting me in for your friendship. Bill, we miss you. Jeffrey, thank you. Six times. Keep it going.
Thank you, bro.
Josh and Liam, heart and soul. Great. Grown up, gone to college for 3 years with us. And Jen, 340 days without complaining ever. And I guess over those 340 days, you had a couple days off because you won one Oscar. You're unbelievable, and you know, just we're all so proud that you led us through. And Woody, I'm gonna hand it over to you. You should say something. Thank you so much, Woody. The Elder States.
No, I never did anything like this, where I did this many movies with other people, and also movies that people love and that I really am proud of and think are great. So, and also just the family there, you know, to see that we won't be doing these anymore together, although we have all stayed in touch with each other. It was a big deal. I cried. Everybody cried. It was emotional.
I just want to say, this is the greatest experience I've ever had. I've done, I don't know, 60 some odd movies, most of which you've probably never heard of. This is an amazing crew, just the most amazing crew I've worked with, most amazing cast. You guys have really, talk about being spoiled. I really feel so spoiled by you guys. So much f-ing laughter. I don't know why I'm crying about it. Anyway, I love you guys. I think this is like a moment in time we're all gonna remember. And like, just, we made something really special together, and I love you guys. Francis.
And that's the thing about some of the more experienced actors and myself, you know, we knew how special this was. When you're 22 or 23, you can kind of get spoiled thinking, well, I guess every movie's like this. We've been around enough to know that they're not. And that's why we valued this experience so much, because we knew how special it was. We knew that the friendships that were made on this were gonna last forever. And, you know, we knew that these kind of situations don't come along very often.
Josh and Liam and Woody and I just kind of held each other for like 2 hours after the wrap party. We just all cuddled like puppies and just held each other. It was really sad.
We really got so close with everyone. And while, you know, of course, we're going to have friendships that continue on for a really long time, there's still like the actual work on the movies, filming it, are finished. And that's like the real bonding. And that's where you spend 12 hours a day for 9 months with people. And so we're definitely going to all be missing that.
It was really emotional. I think it kind of hit us all in the face that we weren't going to be working together all the time. And, you know, we'll stay friends because we've, you know, become such good friends over the years. But it's always hard to have everyone in the same place at the same time, you know. And we had the privilege of working with each other for so long. And it's sad that it's come to an end.
Just trying to win, if you can.
I don't know where I would be without this, and I've created such great relationships with Jen. I mean, Jen is like my best friend. I think the world of her, and I mean, we've become so close. I couldn't imagine not having her in my life.
It was a great film to be involved in simply because of the people. I think Francis is a wonderful director, and everybody in the cast, I think the three young leads in particular, you know, Jennifer and Josh and Liam, all set such a tremendously wonderful tone.
Mom, look at me, please! Please say something!
You know, one of the biggest things is just having the support of this family now for the rest of my life. You know, to be able to lean on them and share with them and give to them and have them lean on me and know that we can kind of sort of find each other again in the universe whenever we need.
It is humbling, frankly, to be part of a series that I know is reminiscent of the world around us, you know, is being felt in the world, that we are tapping into something that's real. This isn't all fantasy. Everything that Suzanne wrote about, you can see in the world around us if you look closely enough.
And the world is so interesting. The world is so unusual. And we see now so many books and so many
movies trying to mimic this world or this aesthetic. It's great to be a part of the thing that sort of started it all off.
It's so funny because we as Americans read it as an American story. Oh, it's happening here, this is about our society, but other societies have claimed it as their own too. And it's amazing how really anybody can sort of map themselves out onto Katniss and her dilemmas onto themselves.
These films are epic, and likewise, the making of these films has been something of an epic journey for all of us. And so, it's been a fantastic ride.
We tried to make it fun for everybody, and although, you know, the work's always challenging and difficult, everybody really got along well, and we tried to make it, you know, enjoyable.
This really was the icing on the cake of good fortune. They could do 56 sequels of this movie, I'd be back for every one of them.
For me, I don't do any heavy lifting in these movies, but I really do feel just pleased and proud to be part of it.
As a person, as an actor, you want your career to have scope, to have breadth, and to be able to be involved in a project of this size and this magnitude. And not only to say I did that and experienced it, but to actually grow as a result of it and understand what that means. It's very different from doing a small film.
Do what you came to do.
I would never forgive myself if we'd gotten it wrong. As a fan, let's say, as the person who made a promise to Suzanne, and as a person who feels like the fans are counting on us. So you feel like the people are counting on you and you want to come through for them. And it's been an incredible experience.
It's one of those things that I feel so sort of privileged and honored and blessed to have been a part of that, to kind of experience that with the fans as a fan.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 76th Hunger Games.
It's very happy, you know, at the end of your life to be part of something that fills you with hope.
To be able to make these stories and be around the friends that I've made has been a great 3.5 years. I don't know how I would have done it had the people been a miserable bunch of people, but it hasn't been that way. It's been great.
It hasn't hit me yet. I think that it's gonna hit me when I finish another movie and I don't have these to come home to. Because it always just felt like going home, like going, and I'll be like, you know, and it's always uncomfortable, like on a new movie and kind of getting to know people, and it's always like the first day of school, and then I finish and I'm like, okay, I'm going home. And I don't have that anymore. It's awful. It's terrible. She's gotta write more books.
Lay down your head.
safe. Here it's warm. Here the daisies guard you from every harm. Here your dreams are sweet, and tomorrow brings them true. Here is the